Is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. My friends, good morning, and welcome to this time of worship with Four Corners Community Chapel. This past week, with so many across our country and our world, we watched with shock and sadness as events unfolded in and around our nation's capital on Wednesday. As a people who seek to live our lives and order our commitments in the way of Jesus, we can neither ignore nor remain silent in the face of such injustice. When those with power use their power to cause violence and then deny the part they have played in bringing about hurt and death, we see in the face of its victims one who died upon the cross. And yet, as God's people, we also proclaim that the one who died upon the cross rose again in order to reclaim us and remake us in peace. So we can proclaim, this is the day the Lord has made, and we rejoice in its faith, its hope, and its love. Today we gather in the midst of a world and of a country that feels broken and divided, to do what we have always done, to rejoice in what is good, to share our gifts, and to look to the God who comes alongside us in Christ Jesus to be our neighbor, right our wrongs, heal our wounds, and show us once again what it means to live in love. Whether this is your first time or your 1,000th time being with us here online, I pray that you will find this to be a time of welcome and grace. If you wish to follow along with our service today, I want to encourage you to take a moment and go out to our church website, fourcornerschapel.org, and to click on the Church at Home logo. You can then scroll down to today's date, where you'll find a link for the bulletin that accompanies today's service. A couple notes about our service and our church community. Following our call to worship, which is going to be led for us by Amanda Ioko, our Children's Ministry Director, Ray Janess is going to lead us in singing Great is Thy Faithfulness. Only Ray doesn't know that he's going to do this. And that's because the clip I'm using today is one that Ray recorded last spring during the season of Pentecost. And that's why Ray is wearing shorts in church today. Pentecost, of course, is that season of the year when we tell the story of how long ago the Holy Spirit came upon a world broken and divided and breathed unity all over it. On that day, Ray led us in singing Great is Thy Faithfulness, and this seemed like a good week to reach back into the archives and to pull this song out for us again. And I have no doubt that it will work to bring about that much needed unity. But before we sing, I also want to share with you a couple of happenings going on in ministry and mission. This past week, our missions board took $2,200 worth of your generosity and turned it into Target gift cards that were then donated to 11 families in the Lincoln community who lost their homes last week in an apartment building fire. We pray for those families and for the Lincoln community today, and we give thanks for the way that your faithful support of Four Corners Community Chapel makes it possible for us in turn to care for our neighbors and God's world. Finally, you may remember that when 2020 ended, we had yet to discover the next person who was going to be our next moderator, who was going to lead the work of our church council in this coming year. And I'm pleased to tell you today that Arlen Dow has stepped up to be our moderator for a time. Now, you're going to get to hear from Arlen in the coming weeks, and he will share with you some of the work that awaits us in 2021. But for now, we give God thanks for you, Arlen, and for all those who are leading us in ministry and in witness in 2021. My friends, this is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it as we now listen to our call to worship.
Psalm chapter 40, verses 1 through 5, 11 through 12, and 15 through 17. I waited patiently for the Lord. He inclined to me and heard my cry. He drew me up from the desolate pit, out of the miry bog, and set my feet upon a rock, making my steps secure. He put a new song in my mouth, a song of praise to our God. Many will see and fear and put their trust in the Lord. Happy are those who make the Lord their trust, who do not turn to the proud, to those who go astray after false gods. You have multiplied, O Lord my God, your wondrous deeds and your thoughts toward us. None can compare with you. Were I to proclaim and tell of them, they would be more than can be counted. Do not, O Lord, withhold your mercy from me. Let your steadfast love and your faithfulness keep me safe forever. For evils have encompassed me without number. My iniquities have overtaken me until I cannot see. They are more than the hairs of my head, and my heart fails me. But may all who seek you rejoice and be glad in you. May those who love your salvation say continually, "Great is the Lord." As for me, I am poor and needy, but the Lord takes thought for me. You are my help and my deliverer. Do not delay, O my God.
Holy God, in this precious hour we pause and gather to hear your word. To do so, we break from our work responsibilities, from our fantasies, from our laziness. We move from our fear that overwhelms us, and from the ambitions that are much too strong. Free us from these moments, from every distraction, that we may focus to listen, that we may hear, that we may change. This we pray in the name of the one who is faithful always, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Our scripture lesson this morning comes from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 3. Let us listen together to the word of the Lord. In the 15th year of the reign of Emperor Tiberius, when Pontius Pilate was governor of Judea, and Herod was ruler of Galilee, and his brother Philip, ruler of the region of Iturea and Trachonitis, and Lysanias, ruler of Abilene, during the high priesthood of Annas and Caiaphas, the word of God came to John, son of Zechariah, in the wilderness. He went into all the region around the Jordan, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins, as it is written in the book of the words of the prophet Isaiah.
The voice of one crying out in the wilderness, "Prepare the way of the Lord, make his paths straight. Every valley shall be filled, and every mountain and hill shall be made low. And the crooked shall be made straight, and the rough ways made smooth, and all the flesh shall see the salvation of God."
Now when all the people were baptized, and when Jesus also had been baptized and was praying, the heaven was opened, and the Holy Spirit descended upon him in bodily form like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The struggle I feel myself having today is in trying to figure out where I'm supposed to stand in relationship to the events of this past Wednesday. To be perfectly honest, I feel this struggle on both a personal and pastoral level, but more on a pastoral level. If we accept for the moment that leaders have followers, and that followers, generally speaking, will follow their leaders, I want to be very careful about where I stand this morning. Because you might follow me and stand beside me, or at least in the same vicinity as me. And I take that as responsibility on my part to lead you well. Hence my struggle in trying to figure out where I'm supposed to stand this morning. One option would be for me to distance myself completely from what took place in Washington this past week. Back way up, say that what happened there was politics alone, and church and politics don't mix, let alone match. So leave it to someone else to provide reflection today on what happened there. Sure, as a church, we can pray for the injured and pray especially for those who lost their lives. But draw the line there. Leave the commentary about who is to blame for having caused the injury to the pundits and networks. Let the sociologists talk about the effects of racism and white supremacy and the dangers of putting too much power in the hands of individuals and mobs. Let someone else parse the difference between words like insurrection, sedition, and protest. This is church. Try to even wade into those other waters and you risk getting pulled in and pulling all the rest of us in with you. And while some of us will be glad to go for a swim, others will say, this is neither the time nor place. So I thought about just backing away from what happened this past Wednesday. Besides, I figure you have already decided in your own head and heart what you think about it all. And even before this past Wednesday, I already trusted you to know how to live peaceably with all. Still, backing away completely doesn't tell me where I'm supposed to stand. So I've thought about maybe standing on Scripture. This is what Martin Luther did back in 1517, believing that the authority of his fellow Catholic priests and of the Pope had become abusive, Luther went and nailed 95 theses to the doors of a church in Wittenberg, Germany. Woven throughout the pages of his theses was the idea of solo scriptura, scripture alone. Scripture alone, Luther said, is sufficient authority for Christian faith and practice. Luther didn't see the role of the priest pastor in his day as being meaningless, just overblown. And one way to reform them, he thought, one way to bring them back down to the earth is to limit their authority as interpreters for God. A simple layman armed with scripture is greater than the mightiest pope with it, he said. So with help from the invention of the printing press, Bibles became widely available in every home across Europe. No longer did people need to go to church to listen to a pontiff pontificate on scripture and the will and truth of God. Now they could read it and interpret it for themselves. And as for the church, the Sunday gathering, it was not meaningless to Luther either. The community of faith simply became the place where everyone, priest, pastor, and people alike, came together to hear the word of God as a call to unity. So who am I to go into what happened this past Wednesday and to tell you what God may or may not have to say about it? If you want to know, if I want to know, if we want to know, Scripture alone can tell us. The sticky wicket in this approach is that we've all been reading the same scriptures for nearly 2,000 years now. And the Jewish community has been reading it for even longer than that. And still, we can't all seem to agree on what it has to say. Take me and my friend, Terry. On Wednesday night, she posted on Facebook the story about Jesus falling asleep in the boat. You know the one. The disciples are out rowing against a hurricane and Jesus is sawing Z's. They shake him awake. Jesus, aren't you afraid for us? He gets up, tells the storm to shut up, and then turns to his disciples and says, "No. Why? Should I be afraid for you? Have you still no faith?" My friend Terry posted this story and commented by saying that the point of the story is to show us that nothing is ever as bad as it seems, and that as far as Wednesday goes, we just need to sleep it off. Be like Jesus. In the morning, we'll see. Cooler heads will have prevailed. I commented back, "Yes, but what if that's not the point of the story? Or worse, what if this story isn't the right story for us right now?" I kept thinking about another Bible story where the roles are reversed. Jesus is the one facing a storm, and it is a storm with far greater things going on than just wind and waves. He's in a garden on the night before he is going to be crucified. He knows it's coming. His whole ministry has been among the poor in spirit, the poor in body, the poor in privilege, the poor victims of a religious system that cannot be told apart from an economic system that has been built to keep those who are already at the top from falling off and not to lift up those who have bottomed out. But Jesus in his ministry has not just been among the poor, he has also been for the poor. And this has required Jesus to speak truth to this power and to call out for a kind of greatness that is based on service to the least, and to preach a kind of faith that can be known only on crosses and in tombs. And so on this night, he sits in a garden, knowing full well that he needs to keep watch for tomorrow. And he assumes his disciples, who have said that they will follow him anywhere, he assumes they are also keeping watch. Instead, he turns over to find them asleep. "Wake up! Could you not keep watch for 1 hour? What if the Bible story we need right now is not one where we sleep it off until morning with Jesus, but one where he rails against us for falling asleep when we should have been staying awake? No question, by the end of the day on Wednesday, I needed sleep. I also needed to make sure I wasn't falling asleep to what I should be keeping watch for. Sleep is necessary. Sleep is also a proven form of avoidance. It allows us to turn away from what we would rather not hear, to shut out responsibility, to silence the voices of those who have maybe already too long been silenced. Sleep means that we don't have to figure out where to stand. I don't know who was right about what to think and what to do following this past Wednesday's events on Capitol Hill, me or my friend Terry. I don't know which part of Scripture sounds about right to you today. The part where we fall asleep under the watchful eye of God, or the part where we keep watch with God through the night. I don't know where I'm supposed to stand. What I do know is that the writers of Scripture had this same struggle. In the opening verses of our Scripture lesson today, Luke describes the Word of God as coming to John in the wilderness. That John is out in the wilderness is a reflection of just how crowded the rest of the world has become. Luke tells us himself, "It was the year of the reign of Emperor Tiberius. Pontius Pilate was governor of Judea, and Herod was ruler of Galilee, and his brother Philip, ruler of the region of Iturea and Trachonitis, and Lysanias, ruler of Abilene. It was during the high priesthood of Annas and Caiaphas." That's a lot of players, all trying to keep a hold on power. In a world like that, who do you stand next to? Herod? Philip? Caiaphas? Annas? Who do you stand next to? John's answer is to stand in the wilderness. John is in the wilderness not because he is avoiding power, but because he is standing up to it. For Luke will go on to tell us that John has already called out Herod for sleeping with his own brother's wife. And even out in the wilderness, Herod is going to come and find him and lock him up. So there is John. He does not need halls of power to feel powerful. His power is in the open air and in the river of baptism, where everyone, those high up in the mountains and those down in the empty valleys, those out on the crooked highways and those out on the rough plains, yes, even those who are holed up in their halls of power, everyone can find room out in the wilderness and down in the water. So that's where John is. Out where there is nothing to keep us from having the world the way that we want it, so long as we have the courage to stand next to each other. Last Saturday, a week ago yesterday, I took my dog Quimby to the groomers. Here's a picture of her. Now, I love it when Quimby goes to the groomers. She comes back feeling so soft and fluffy. Her teeth are clean and her breath doesn't smell like the root of some dead plant she just chewed up and swallowed. When she comes back from the groomers, I don't mind if she sits on the couch. I don't even mind if she sits on me. That was Saturday. On Sunday afternoon, we all got in the car, Mora, Lillian, Rowan, and me, and Quimby, and we took a ride out to the distant country of Western Rhode Island to visit my brother-in-law and his family and to celebrate my nephew's 4th birthday. My brother-in-law and his family, they have a big yard and it's perfect for kids and for dogs to run around in. Quimby bounded out of the car and made a beeline for the backyard. And that's when my brother-in-law yelled out, "You might want to stop her." It turned out their neighbor, whose yard runs right into theirs, was having a bit of an issue with their septic tank. Quimby, more of a bloodhound than a golden retriever, ran straight into the pile of muddy green quicksand, dragging her nice new blue and yellow leash around her neck. "Get back here!" I said in my most master-sounding voice. She didn't hear me. Or she did. Her paws sank in deep, so deep that her belly disappeared. And when she finally came to her own senses, she climbed out of the sewer and, of course, ran right for us. "No, no, get away!" all the adults yelled. But my nephew, who in human years is about the same age as Quimby, thought that it was great fun. "Quimby! Quimby!" he held out his arms to her. We just came through Christmas. At Christmas, we hold out our arms to the God who comes to us as a baby. In my mind's eye, at Christmas, Jesus looks a bit like my dog after getting groomed. He's soft and lily white. There's a glow about him as he sits there on Mary's lap, all calm and bright. Of course, that's not at all how the story goes. In actuality, Mary had no place to lay her baby, let alone any grooming tools that she could use to clean him up with. Labor and delivery is messy and bloody. Unless we think that Jesus was lily white, think again. He was Middle Eastern. The Savior of the world was more black than white that night. But thank God this is how the story goes. Jesus came into the world, the hope of all creation, covered in human skin. He grew up. And many years later, Luke records, he found his way out into the wilderness with everyone else. Out to where all the crooks and sinners, the powerful and the powerless, were putting down their flags and taking off their clothes, to climb down into the waters of baptism together, to make a change, to come clean with God and with one another. And that water, after a while, it looked like a sewer. And there was Jesus, the hope of all creation, standing in it with us. Amen.
I'm one. time to weep. Life just won't let up. I know that you can give me your rest. So I cry out with all that I have left. Let me see redemption win. Let me know the struggle ends. You can mend a heart that's frail and torn. I wanna know a song can rise from the ashes of a broken life, and all that's dead inside can be reborn. 'Cause I'm warm, my prayers are wearing thin. Yeah, I'm warm even before the day begins. Oh, I'm warm, I've lost my will to fight. And I'm warm, so heaven come and flood my eyes. Let me see redemption win. Let me know the struggle ends. You can mend a heart that's frail and torn. I wanna know a song can rise from the ashes of a broken life, and all that's dead inside can be reborn. Yes, all that's dead inside will be reborn. Though I'm born, yeah, I'm born.
O God, our help in ages past, we come today as people in need. The ground upon which we stand, the ground of our homeland, the ground we built to be decent and orderly, continues to quiver and quake, leaving our hearts anxious, our spirits disquieted, our resolve wearied. So we pray your steady hand upon our nation.
Hold steady our leaders, support them with courage and conviction. Make them bold with wisdom and humility. Protect them from violence and harm, but also protect them from casual thinking and cavalier decisions.
Hold steady our hope that our system of checks and balances would hold, that those in power would choose the greater good over personal gain, that justice is more than a dream.
Hold steady our truth, that the power of love is always ultimately stronger than the love of power, that there is no brokenness you cannot bind up and no death you cannot raise up, that you alone are our sovereign God, our saving Christ, and our sustaining spirit.
O God, our help in ages past, there was a time before when chaos hovered, when it covered the fullness of all that was. From that chaos, you brought forth creation.
You knew that we would always need help to see, and so you said, "Let there be light," and it was so.
You knew we would need a vast expanse and a settled rest, and so you said, "Let there be water, sky, and land," and it was so.
You knew we would need growth and renewal, sustenance and strength, and so you said, "Let there be plants and fruits and trees," and it was so.
You knew we would need rhythms and routines, and so you said, "Let there be day and night, signs and seasons," and it was so.
You knew we would need to be reminded there is more to this life than just ourselves, and so you said, "Let there be living creatures of every kind, animals and cattle, fish and fowl, everything that creeps and crawls. And it was so. And then you said, let there be humanity.
You have spoken creation out of chaos before, O God. From the depths of nothing, you brought forth humanity. And so we pray that you would do so again. Speak your word, O God, and bring forth our humanity. Bring forth the best in us. Bring forth everything you always intended for us and from us. Bring forth everything in us that is good and very good. Once again, O God, bring forth our humanity. Let it be so.
O God, our help in ages past, be our hope for years to come, this day and every day that follows. Amen.
Let us go forth this day to stand beside each other in the world, in the spirit of the one who has come to stand beside us, Jesus Christ. Let us support the weak, feed the hungry, return no one evil for evil, hold fast to what is good, rejoice in the Holy Spirit, and love God and our neighbor with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. Let us go forth, and may the love of God, the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, and the power and presence of the Holy Spirit go with, be with, and keep you, now and forevermore. Amen.
Let us pause in life's pleasures and count its many tears, while we also sorrow with the poor. There's a song that will linger forever in our ears. Oh, hard times come again no more. 'Tis a song, the sigh of the weary. Hard times come again no more. Many a days you have lingered around my cabin door. Oh, hard times come again no more. While we seek mirth and beauty and music, light and gay, there are frail forms fainting at the door. Though their voices are silent, their pleading looks will say, oh, hard times come again no more. 'Tis the song, the sigh of the weary. Hard times come again no more. Days you have lingered all around my cabin door. Oh, hard times come again.